distinguished Vassar audiences. It's always important to stipulate in front of a group such as this that we are all achievers in our chosen fields. But the difference between most of us and those few rare distinguished achievers among us may be this. In their lives, ordinary things can result in extraordinary change. For regular folks, and I think in another speech I referred to us comparatively as slackers, having a baby will change our lives. For a distinguished achiever, having a baby might change millions of lives. That's certainly the case for tonight's honoree. Laurie Schwab Zabin, class of 1946, was well on her way to a successful career in English literature when she became pregnant and chose Dr. Alan Guttmacher as her obstetrician. Guttmacher, the prominent population scientist and reproductive rights advocate, engaged her on these issues. She became a volunteer and then a staff member at Planned Parenthood, working first in some of the poorest neighborhoods in Baltimore, and then as a national and international advocate for reproductive rights. As Kathy said earlier, at the age of 53, Laurie's passion for population issues led her back to academia. She returned to Johns Hopkins to pursue an advanced degree in public health and was promptly told that she lacked not just one, but every single prerequisite for the program. Something to think about with law school, Kathy. Yeah. Nevertheless, Laurie wrangled in acceptance and earned her doctorate in social demography and population dynamics. It was the late 1970s, a critical time for population control worldwide. The environmental movement spawned concerns about a global population crisis, and in this country, teenage pregnancy rates were nearing all-time highs. Using her research skills as well as her clinical background, Laurie created a groundbreaking program that linked clinics to high schools to provide health care for young women at risk. The program became a national model, and Laurie Zabin, English literature scholar, became a nationally recognized expert on teenage pregnancy. In 1997, she got a call from a friend in Seattle about a potential funding source for an organization that would focus on international population and reproductive health. Bill and Melinda Gates had a little money to spend, but a lot of skepticism about the academic approach, although they agreed to meet with Laurie Zabin and her colleagues at Johns Hopkins, and they came away impressed. In 1998, Dr. Zabin became the founding director of the Bill and Melinda Gates Institute for Population and Reproductive Health, with a mission to help developing countries create their own reproductive health policies and programs. The AAVC Award for Distinguished Achievement that Dr. Zabin receives tonight is given annually to a Vassar graduate who has demonstrated exceptional qualities of talent, application, creativity, and skill within a chosen profession. This person must also exemplify the ideals of a liberal arts education and use her or his position to better the human community and serve the wider goals of society. Dr. Zabin's academic work has always been uniquely informed by her insistence on going back into the field frequently and continuing to work with healthcare providers. She's a demographer who doesn't cite statistics, but who tells stories about women she knows whose lives change when their reproductive decisions are not random, ill-informed, or controlled by others. Among her first projects at Planned Parenthood was an effort to change governmental policies that restricted healthcare providers from answering low-income women's questions about what kept rich people from having so many babies. Because the American Medical Association, the medical community's bellwether organization, opposed contraception until 1964, access to reproductive choice wasn't just a question of personal freedom, but of class, economic empowerment, and creating meaningful social change for women, their families, and entire communities. These important issues have echoed throughout the decades of Dr. Zabin's career, including the Gates Foundation programs in Africa, and her own new research on young adults in the increasingly affluent and westernized cultures of China and Vietnam. Before I present this award, I must tell all of you what an impact Dr. Zabin's visit has had on our campus. Spencer Miller. For any of us who attended her lecture yesterday, her class this morning, had tea with some students with her, or dare I say, a drink with her last night, Laurie exemplifies not only the best of Vassar, but she is a role model for making a difference, connecting with people, keeping a sense of humor, staying intellectually engaged, and at the same time being incredibly down to earth. She has been a delight to have on campus, and so it is my privilege to present the 2008 AAVC Award, Distinguished Achievement Award, to Dr. Laurie Schwab.
There's just no way to thank all of you for this wonderful happening, for the entire visit, and of course for this totally undeserved award. My warmest appreciation goes to everybody who shared in this occasion, of course to Kathy, who has been such a joy to come to know. I had looked forward to our meeting as one of the important things of coming onto campus. To Meg, and the AAVC, and of course to Joe. Where's Joe? There he is. And that mysterious committee that I understand I will never know anything about. That did it. So, everybody that made it possible, those who made these incredibly complex arrangements, Brooke and Pat, where are they? There's Brooke. Who made these arrangements for these incredible days. And those in my family who are here tonight, my son Louis Strauss, Anne and Burton Carlitz, daughter and son-in-law of my late and glorious husband. All three of them, I hope some of you had a chance to meet over cocktails and maybe will afterwards. And those in my family who aren't here, my parents who made this whole wonderful life possible. And remarkably supportive siblings, one of whom is also a Vassar graduate, I should say. My daughters and their exciting families, and those of my husband as well. And countless friends who have been just wonderful, loving supports along the way. And of course, my gratitude goes to the Grand Dame, to Vassar itself. That same vibrant and caring and just remarkable place that I remember from so many decades ago. However humbled all of this makes me feel, I really am very, very deeply grateful. I don't know how many of you were here yesterday when I mentioned that I long had a quotation over my desk from Thomas Jefferson, and it said, "I'm a great believer in luck, and I find the harder I work, the more I have of it." Well, I too have to believe in luck because I really had so very, very much of it. And I will mention a few of those ways, if I may. Some of them Meg has already referred to, because I was asked sort of to share with you tonight some of the landmarks along the path that brings me here. And that path really, for those of you that heard my talk yesterday, that path hasn't changed since yesterday. So you're gonna hear many of the same things that you heard before. But what I did want to say is that those landmarks are almost always people, very remarkable people that make something happen when you least expect it, and then there's a turn in the road ahead. It all began with the most loving and caring family that anybody can possibly imagine, a family that was supportive of learning and sort of expected you to produce something in the rest of your life. I remember as a 10 or 11-year-old sitting at the dining room table while my father was talking very intently to my older brother across the table. He was a couple of years older than I, and of course he was a man. And he was probably all of 13. And my mother said to him, and I still remember this, "Darling, you know Laurie has a brain too." And he turned immediately and made the discussion include us all. And he always did from then on, but I remember that as a very specific moment at which I realized that I was expected to do whatever my brother did. I knew that the wide world, therefore, was sort of open from the beginning, and I still argue to this day with women of my generation who see their lives as limited by the times. A lot of them speak with envy of the of their children's generation and their children's children's generation, and say that, you know, they have it made because now women can do anything they want. Well, I don't think it will ever be easy. I think women will always want to be the best wives, the best homemakers, the best mothers, all of that, as well as doing the jobs that they seek. Or the jobs that many, many people have to have just to keep their families going. But for our generation, I think we were the luckiest of all, at least the fortunate among us, because I think we had the best of both worlds. We could do what we wanted outside the home. Anything that we wanted was within our reach. But if we wanted to stay home and take care of the kids, nobody criticized us for that. So I really think we had it made. We had it both ways. Now, after very exciting schooling in New York City, Vassar was a wonderful bastion of learning. And it was a fortunate place to spend what were really very difficult years, because I remember those years with happiness in terms of being here. And when I come here, I recall that part of it. When I started really to think about it, these were very difficult years emotionally. Years when my brother, as the brothers of so many in the class, were overseas, as all young men were. When tragic news would literally come in and you'd hear down the corridor that somebody's brother had just been lost. There were very few social occasions, and they were very often when somebody came to say goodbye before leaving for overseas. These were not emotionally easy years, but it was a wonderful place to spend them. For those that don't know Vassar's history, we were the only girls' college that went on to a three-year plan. 3 years, 10 months a year, classes 6 days a week, as well as doing all the work, because there weren't the people doing the cleaning or the message center or any of the other jobs, the waiting table and so on. It made for a very, very intense intellectual atmosphere, because the people that didn't want that simply didn't come. They didn't need to. There was a man named John Malcolm Brennan, a poet, who later brought Dylan Thomas to America, and he introduced me to the Welsh poet's very challenging poetry. And we had to send to England to get the verses because they hadn't been published here. And I remember the beating he took from the older faculty in the department that absolutely couldn't stand the idea that somebody could get a degree working on poetry that hadn't even been published here yet. They were furious at him. There was another professor, Morris Weitz, a new philosophy professor, who turned my minor field into a really major part of my education. And Vassar then sent me on to Harvard for a master's, thinking that there was a very clear academic path ahead. It just didn't work out that way. After a first job as assistant editor of the Shakespeare Association Quarterly, and most of a PhD in English at Hopkins, luck happened. Just exactly what Meg mentioned to you, amen. A man by the name of Guttmacher, who delivered my son over here, and before he left Baltimore. Maybe that was too much for him, son. Is that what you did? I never thought of that. Anyway, he turned me to talk about the needs in the developing world and here, and turned me to Planned Parenthood, first in Baltimore, then on the national level, then internationally, and so on. And the then director of Maryland Planned Parenthood was another heroine. She pushed me to cast the die in this new career and insisted that I go on staff to run a clinic during the war on poverty. I notice today in talking and yesterday talking to students how much time has passed. So few even know that there was the war on poverty, the community action agencies and so on. But anyway, working with Target City Congress of Racial Equality during the Martin Luther King riots, and hearing and seeing the desperation and hopes and often hopelessness of that community had a huge impression on me. There's one episode that I wanted to share that committed me to family planning for life. A young woman came in with real urgency in her desire to get services. Now, most of the people that came in this very depressed neighborhood were rather laconic. You know, they just sort of came and they took what came, but she was really eager. I was driving her home to get written permission from her mother. She was under 21 and unmarried, so she had to have written permission from her mother. And I asked her why she was so committed and so excited about receiving contraception. And she said, "I got a letter from Job Corps this morning, and nothing's going to stop me now." And that was it, that sense of empowerment that I saw as women brought their lives under control. And these exciting glimpses through volunteer work in the larger international scene made me seek academia again. I thought I could do more if I understood that broader world of population, and the learning was very close by at Johns Hopkins School of Public Health. Luck again. Henry Mosley, a wonderful man who headed the Department of Population Dynamics, has a connection here at Vassar. He didn't at the time. I think some of you know that connection. He came by this evening, Paul Mosley, who is in your Department of Dance on your faculty. Today, his son he comes to see his son here at Vassar and is very, very impressed. And he let in this 48-year-old. Yes, I was 48 when I started. I graduated at 53. But without a single prerequisite, I guess it was sort of a gamble. And he's been a linchpin in my career ever since and still is today. Now, once more, luck stepped in because there were two professors who had collected the very first national data on teenage girls' behavior in the US. And they let me use their data for a thesis. And on the basis of that work, years of research followed. A call the day of my doctoral defense from the head of GYNOB gave me an appointment and a whole different set of colleagues in the School of Medicine, and then moved back at Mosley's request to the department that's now Population, Family, and Reproductive Health. I was always really interested in that intersection between science and the real world, in the application of really rigorous research to real world policy and program. And we addressed issues like the timing and the delay to the first contraceptive visit. And as you know, it was too long. Factors involved that influenced clinic attendance, the consequences, the true consequences of abortion, and they were amazingly positive, and the role of women's intentions in preventing or promoting pregnancy. So research findings often led then into involvement with real world, either in government or the NGO sector, or even in the courtroom, which I found some of the most interesting. And the students at the school were an unending source of excitement, helping a Kenyan student to collect data in isolated villages in the Rift Valley, and working with a Chilean postdoc. All these things really made a huge impression. But I didn't do anything like the professors at the school who spent most of their lives in the developing world and who I admired so from a distance. So some years later, when I was almost 70, I thought it was time to retire, and luck rang the bell. This time it was a phone call. "There's a man named Gates wants to see you." Well, it turned out to be Papa Gates, who was starting the foundation for his son, and he wanted to talk about what might be done in the field of population. When I got him to visit the school, the die was cast the minute he met the wonderful people there. And as I took him to his car at the end, he kept saying, "These students, they blow my mind. If only Trey and Melinda could meet these students, they are fantastic." And I love to remind the faculty at our school that it was not they, but the students that really enchanted him. He found out very soon that a school of public health was not just a university, but could create the in-country capacity to address serious problems. And at first, through Mosley's teaching of strategic leadership, within a year, the design of our Institute of Population and Reproductive Health that bears the names of Bill and Melinda Gates. And their foundation made it possible for us to build these strong cadres in many, many parts of the world. And we bring together now these cohorts of fellows and partners that have grown and thrived under my successor's direction. And I've been able to work with our wonderful chair on new programs, on programs to inaugurate a department program in adolescence and youth, on a newly conceived program in advocacy and policy, because we're so fed up with ideology taking the place of science in the current world. And we think that we need to train young people to be able to get out there and develop the real facts and get them out to the people that are making policy. And especially a very thrilling research project that Meg mentioned that has brought China and Taiwan to work together with Vietnam and us on a three-city study of the dramatic changes that are going on in adolescents' lives as their Asian or Confucian values are being left behind in the modern world. When I think back to the 60s and 70s, they were very exciting times. The international world was struggling with the relationship between development and population. The domestic world here took on the responsibility of making contraception funding finally possible. Before then, I don't think people realized that nobody could get any that couldn't afford a private doctor unless there was a Planned Parenthood nearby. And so that first funding that went into family planning was supremely important. And speaking of supreme, the Supreme Court took on Roe v. Wade. So it was amazing to watch the ability of the pill to empower women and of education and control of their own fertility to move them to a level of independence that they'd never experienced. And there was growing acceptance, even in the most conservative societies in the world, of the importance of children by choice and not chance. All of these seemed ideas that were part of the world now and would stay that way. We could never have dreamed in the 70s that we'd be fighting these same battles again today. That in the new millennium, we would actually be fighting battles we thought had been settled way back in the 70s. The power of the radical right to take away those hard-won promises is frightening, and their willingness to replace science with ideology to do that has set us back decades, and we have a lot to do. In that vein, I was thinking about the word achievement, which you've honored me with tonight, and it led me to think and ask a question and then say, do I have a right to ask this question at a happy meeting like this? And I decided that I had to do it. Should our generation, or any generation, should we take pride in genuine achievement when we've let our country sink to the depths it is in today? What would we think of another nation with as glorious a heritage of values and togetherness and care for the world that our so-called greatest generation had, that we experienced, and then allowed the tragedies of the last years to take place under our flag? From the Marshall Plan to Vietnam and Iraq in our time. There's an individual level of achievement, I guess, although I agree with Mother Teresa who said, we can't do great things. We can only do small things with great love. But more important, there are fields of collective endeavor, science or communication, engineering or medicine. In many, there has been very dramatic progress in our time. But is there real achievement? If as a national community, we're moving backwards. I don't want to put a damper on this occasion, but I think we have to ask ourselves to look at our communal endeavors, to look at our communal achievement, and to turn our energies to mending the tragic failures of the last years. It won't be easy to bring back the place of respect that our country once had in the eyes of the world, to renew the social contract, a term that has sort of disappeared from our lexicon, and to bring back a decent level of equity in our country, and to share with the poverty-stricken here and throughout the world the moral equivalent of the Marshall Plan, to work for peace in our time. But without communal achievement, ours and I hope the generations that are following us, I don't think any of us can feel our missions accomplished or feel much pride. There's so much to be done, and of whom should we ask the most? If not of those who have had the immeasurable benefits and delights of education such as ours. Education that has touched our minds, yes, but also our senses and I hope our hearts. Education broad enough so we can't be blind to the needs of the world, deep enough to prepare us for service in one area or another. I just don't see how we can talk about achievement unless we address those demands and those needs that are waiting for us. But for tonight, I do want to return to the joyous spirit of the occasion, to thank you all for the joy you've given me and my family, the joy that my family has given me by being here tonight, the joy that this award will bring me in the years and years ahead when I really will try to deserve it. Thank you very much.